real estate back again.
It doesn't seem like a week. Oh, it wasn't.
No.
Right, your so promo. You didn't play the promo for the Thinking Real Estate.
The house.
See, it's going to come up Thursday.
Is that
how it's programmed? It's queued in?
Yeah.
And well, you can't change that?
Okay. Yeah, well, of course I can.
Yeah.
Did I think about it? No.
But you were thinking real estate, though, right?
I was.
So we're getting really excited.
We promoted the move all weekend.
I appreciate that. I heard it on the way out here, too. And I heard the promo for ours is pretty funny. That's abnormal. Conversation.
That's a pretty normal conversation. Yeah.
I thought it was, and that's why we
clipped it. That's why you picked it.
Yes.
Nice. Well, Amazing Race is coming up on Saturday. Bill, how are your points going?
I don't know. Jackie would have to tell me how the points are because she's keeping track of all that stuff.
Are you keeping track?
I'm not sure.
Do you do that for all the contestants, Jackie?
Still looking for sponsors.
Oh, nice.
Alex Cash and I are still looking for sponsors.
Okay. So,
anybody interested, call, what's the number, Jackie?
782-7011.
And say Bill's name.
Say Schlechty Cash.
I had some ideas on the way out here. You could have those same ideas.
Yeah, well, hand them over to me. I could use the points.
That I don't cheat.
Yeah, nor do I.
Do you have sponsorships still available?
Yeah, just a few left. We have a couple signs left, which is only $25, and it gets foot traffic into your store. So if you have that challenge, it would be worth $25. And then an after party and an event, so you could go up to $1,000. Our title sponsor is AT&T, which is very cool, and of course Thinking Real Estate.
Very good.
Gotta raise $9,000 for the fitness council. That's our goal. And then there's only 10 team spots left, and there's a voicemail for me, so there might only be 9. And Jackie's got a couple.
How many teams do you have?
40. It'll be 40. Total of 40.
That's a lot.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
How many did you have last year?
17.
Okay. Wow.
We think big. We think real estate, and we think big. Hey, you know what? The Fitness Council is an awesome organization.
But you said Fitness Council?
Fitness.
No, I thought you said Fitness Council. I thought this was something to do with podiatry.
You do use your feet in fitness.
Yeah, you do.
Usually.
There. All right.
But a Fitness Council. All right, so I have a client.
All right, so we're interrupting the conversation we started last Thursday, because we said we were going to continue it till today.
Because we
were dealing with encroachments, but there were several other issues. But that's okay. We can hold that one.
Well, you can talk about anything for any length of time, whether you know anything about it or not.
That's what I understand. Okay. So, all right, what do you want to, we're going to take a...
I told someone this morning that you were the best real estate attorney in the state of Michigan.
Well, that's very kind of you to say that. Okay, I really appreciate that, particularly since it's my wife.
You could be biased, but
she'd be biased
against me, actually.
Right, I would say that even if we were in the throes of a divorce, which, based on that promo, could happen.
Yeah, it's being filed tomorrow. All right, so you want to take ideas from that conversation?
Yeah,
you know,
each week something new comes up. Someone was telling me about if you have a piece of property and you have a name that's for sale. Now maybe there's a couple issues here. It's for sale and the neighboring property doesn't want you to sell it for whatever reason.
I've heard this happen
a couple of times.
It happens, I don't want to say frequently, but often enough that it's a problem. And typically the neighbor doesn't want the property sold to somebody else because the neighbor wants the property. That's usually what happens. The neighbor wants the property. So go ahead.
Well, there was one, I think, a couple of years ago where the neighbor just was mean, and it was out on a lake. And I don't know if they didn't want to buy the property, but they really made it hell for the seller to sell it. But in any event.
By doing what?
Every time someone showed the property, they would come over and talk poorly about the property or about the area. They just were intentionally interfering with the property being sold. In fact, they lost sales based on the neighbor.
Okay, and not only is it somebody talking mean, sometimes they do things of a nature to create a disturbance or a nuisance, not just saying bad things about the property,
right.
But doing
like
doing
parking
things.
Their junk cars right next to the boundary where you can see it.
Help me out. Why would they even be allowed on the property?
They're not allowed on the property.
While you were showing it.
No, they're not on the property. They're saying it from their property.
Well, no, but sometimes they come onto the property. But, you know, the agent isn't going to know any different. I mean, the listing agent might know, but typically it's a buyer's agent that's at the property showing the property, not the listing agent. And unless the buyer's agent calls the listing agent and tells them this is happening, the listing agent might not even know what's happening.
Yeah, but if a person's coming onto the property, that's easy to stop. That's a trespass. Usually the circumstance isn't a trespass. A person's shouting over the boundary line, or they're doing things on their own property along the boundary line to try and create a situation, a circumstance, or a condition that a purchaser's going to look at that and say, my God, you know, I'm not going to move into this neighborhood because of what's going on at this
right.
property. I mean,
so what does the seller do in that case?
Depends on how egregious the action is, but you actually said it. There's a cause of action. If the person is doing it out of spite, and it's actually malicious, there's a cause of action called intentional interference with a contract. So that if a contract is actually in a place, an offer has been accepted by a seller, and now the parties are doing the due diligence and doing the things necessary to get to a closing, and the neighbor is doing things or saying things to deliberately interfere with that contract, there's actually a cause of action in Michigan and in many states called intentional interference with a contractual relationship. And you can file a claim in the district or circuit court depending upon the amount of damages. If it's in excess of $25,000, then you go to the circuit court. And you file an action to get damages, and you might actually be able to get an injunction to stop the action if it constitutes a nuisance. If it's perhaps it's violating a local ordinance or doing something else, you might be able to stop the activity. But the cause of action is intentional interference with a contract. Now, if you don't have a contract in place,
if you have a
listing agreement,
sale.
Sure, the listing agreement is a contract. It would be intentional interference with that contract. But there's also a cause of action in Michigan that is recognized called intentional interference with a business expectancy. And that's, even though you don't have a contract, you have a business expectancy in the form of selling the property and making a profit. And intentional interference with that is a cause of action. So the person who's selling the property does have a potential remedy if the action is done deliberately and for the purpose of interfering with that kind of.
Is this something
are you
that
aware of successful lawsuits?
Yeah, sure. It happens all the time. I've actually prosecuted. I've brought claims over the years for intentional interference that have been successful.
Well, how quickly
sure.
does something like that move? So I've got our property for sale right now, and the neighbor intentionally parks his
this
vehicle.
This is a hypothetical because it's not happening.
Right.
The hypothetical is you list your property for sale.
Right. And in fact, we had a property for sale a few years ago, and that was an issue. The property owner, seller that I had, actually ended up putting up a fence to help
block off
the problem and activity. Now, in that particular case, I think that the property owner, like, they had a lot of cars. I think they always had a lot of cars, so I'm not sure they did anything unusual to add to the dilemma of selling that property. But what if how quickly could you file something to get the person to stop doing what they're doing?
Well, you couldn't sue somebody because they had a lot of cars.
No, but if they never had cars there, now all of a sudden the house is for sale and they put all their junk cars there.
Well,
it's.
And who's to say they're junk cars? I'm just, you know.
Well, simply parking cars in and of itself does not create a cause of action.
Right.
However,
now,
the
if you
motive,
had them on the lawn and
well, no, if the motive in parking the cars there is to intentionally interfere with the contract, even though legally you could legally park the cars there, the underlying motivation is to interfere with the contract, that does create a cause of action. In other words, I can use legal acts.
Tough to prove?
Very. Yeah. That one's a tough one to prove.
The
so
car one.
Yeah,
but if all of a sudden I put pigs in my backyard.
Yeah, and even though you're out in a township and it may be legal, the fact that I'm doing this, I never had them before, if I can prove that it's being done to interfere. And usually,
tough to prove.
Well, here's what usually happens. Usually there's extrinsic evidence in the form of the neighbor who wanted to buy the property has made an offer, low ball, it gets rejected, etc. So there's a history here of dealing in which the neighbor's offer has been rejected. Very often there's conversation, and very often there are statements. There could even be voicemail messages, etc. That can be used as extrinsic evidence to show the motivation of the neighbor in undertaking these particular acts or making these particular statements. But you're right, it is a difficult cause of action, but that doesn't mean that it's impossible. It's like any lawsuit, you know, you have to be able to prove your case.
Well, so back to my question, how quickly can something like that be implemented? Because if I have a property for sale, I'm in this market, I'm going to get an offer on it probably relatively quickly, and the neighbor is now doing something damaging. I don't want to jeopardize my ability to, as a realtor, I don't want to jeopardize my ability to sell that property, nor do I want to be dishonest to any people within the transaction, and the seller wants to get the property sold. So how quickly can you move?
Here's what's going to happen. I can get the lawsuit filed. You're going to ask for a preliminary injunction and a permanent injunction, but the odds of getting that are very small. And the reason I say that is one of the conditions to get an injunction is the plaintiff must show irreparable harm. And because the interference with a contract creates a cause of action for damages, even though now the sale has been prevented and you're not going to be able to sell it unless and until this problem is solved, you still have a cause of action for damages. And under the listing agreement, as a broker, you actually could bring a cause of action that the neighbor is interfering with their listing contract, and the seller can bring the cause of action. But because the major claim is money damages, it's going to be very difficult. If you could convince a judge that money damages are insufficient to compensate you for your loss as a result of the neighbor's actions. In other words, now the neighbor's actions have made the property not just saleable at a lower price, but made it completely unsaleable. If I could prove that by clear and convincing evidence, then I could get a judge to issue an injunction stopping the activity. But I'm here to tell you that you're going to be engaged in a process which is going to take a significant period of time. I can get before the judge in a short period of time, but whether or not I'm going to get injunctive relief as a result of that quick hearing, that's going to be tough.
Would getting in front of a judge or even a harsh letter from a really good attorney maybe motivate the person to stop doing what they're doing?
Well, getting before a judge, once you file a lawsuit, you got to be prepared to carry it through. Don't call it a harsh letter, call it a firmly worded letter from a qualified attorney may prompt the other side to stand up and take notice, particularly if they go to a lawyer who likewise has the qualifications to properly advise that neighbor. If I'm the lawyer advising the neighbor, I'm going to tell him or her, stop. Stop doing it. You're going to make yourself liable, potentially liable for interfering with the contract. You don't want to do that. Back off. That would be my advice.
Yeah, not to mention the attorney fees you're going to have to pay.
That too. Most people are unaware of this cause of action, and they think that they can harass people and threaten people or make false statements with impunity. And if they make a false statement, that's also slander.
Now, are there some items that, as a seller, can I call the municipality? And if they're all of a sudden have pigs or they have cars that are parked by the boundaries or...
Well, if it's a violation of the ordinance, sure. Right. Now the township zoning officer can come out. Good luck sometimes getting prompt action from the municipality. Look, municipalities are stretched thin. This probably isn't a high priority for them unless the neighbor has been a bad actor in the past, but that's usually not the case. They're just doing this now as a result of the sale or prospect of sale of the adjoining piece. But yeah, if they have junk cars out there, most municipalities have ordinances that say, you know, if you've got an unlicensed vehicle sitting in your yard, that's a violation of the ordinance. Having farm animals as opposed to domestic pets in many municipalities other than rural places, and despite the Right to Farm Act in Michigan, that would be could be a violation of the ordinance. And you don't just all of a sudden bring pigs onto your property anyway, because not only are you going to be affecting your neighbor, guess who else you're going to be affecting?
Yourself.
Yeah, yourself. and all the other names. Plus, you have to have the facilities
right.
For disposal of the
pig.
Pig residue, yeah.
Yeah.
But, you know, they could have bought them recently at the farm.
Yeah,
or
made
at
them
the,
pets.
At the fair.
Made
I mean.
Them pets, yeah. Make them pets.
Yeah. Right? They could go to the Petunia. Livestock auction at the fair.
Petunia or Willard?
Can you have pigs in the city?
No.
No. Can't even have chickens.
You can't. Are you sure?
Mm-hmm. Pretty sure.
We just had that ordinance. We
ducks.
Just changed that ordinance like 2 years ago.
You can have pheasants under glass, you can have ducks, duck l'orange, right? However you want them fixed, we'll be happy to do that.
There's
oh, you mean live? Oh, yeah.
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 Pets.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah,
pets. Aren't those, aren't there, isn't there a little pig that's kind of like a dog that's
hamster,
a pet?
Isn't hamster a pig? Or is it a rat?
If it's a rodent, I'm sure.
Is it?
Yeah, that would think so.
But aren't there little pigs that are like pet pigs?
Yeah. Like guinea pigs?
Yeah.
Is that what you're thinking of?
I don't know.
Yeah, but a guinea pig isn't a pig. It's a rodent.
Is it?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure. Yeah.
You're that pretty sure.
And I'm pretty sure, yeah. This is sort of out of my field of expertise.
Wait, I thought you knew everything.
Hardly.
As we're going through the
you
race
route. You
can
have guinea pigs.
Yeah, yeah, I'm sure you can have guinea pigs. Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
But there is a little pig that is like a pet. I don't know.
Well,
what
it would
it's
be
called.
A baby.
It's a guinea pig.
It's a
no,
baby pig.
No, it's not a guinea
all right, anyway.
Pig.
So, but that you are not without a remedy as the owner of the property, listing it for sale, trying to market, etc.
I'm looking it up.
No, don't bother. Okay. Then, anyway, you'd have to look at the local ordinance, see if it's a violation, whatever that person is doing.
Part oh, there's part probably someone with the answer to the pig.
Don't want it. Okay?
No.
All right, so does
Hot
that.
Hot belly pig.
Hot belly pig.
Does that answer your question? About the neighbor interfering with the sale?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I think so.
Right.
I just, it's kind of distressing to think that you couldn't do something quicker to at least stop the action.
Well, again, you can try and jump in. I can get you before a judge, but whether or not you satisfy all of the requirements to get an injunction issued.
That would be hard.
That's more difficult, yeah, because the standard of proof, the burden of proof is higher. I must show irreparable harm. Otherwise, if I'm simply entitled to money damages,
well, even
I can't
if
get injunction.
Even if you take the money damage part out of it at the moment in time, I would want to be able to get the person to stop doing what they're doing to minimize any damages
sure.
in the future.
Well, then, as I said before, the one potential irreparable harm that I see is that the action of the neighbor is making the property completely unsaleable. In other words, it's not just a question of instead of selling the property for $200,000, the actions are forcing me to accept a deal at $150,000. The actions of the neighbor are driving every single prospective purchaser away. And what I would want to do as the owner is every time somebody visited the property with or without an agent, I would want to get feedback from that potential purchaser and from the agent as to exactly what was said or what was done by the neighbor that drove them away from that property. And if I can get, you know, if everybody out there says, no, we're not interested, we're not going to move forward, and no offer is forthcoming, then I might be able to persuade the judge that the property is now rendered unmarketable entirely by virtue of the neighbor's actions.
Does it make it more enforceable if there's actually the actions don't start until the neighbor finds out that there's a purchase agreement in place on the property?
Could be. Again, as I said before in response to Greg's question, it was if you've got a history here of prior dealings, you know, the neighbor had made an offer, had conversations with the owner, but you know, the property's listed at 200 and they want to get it for $100,000 and they're miffed because they can't get it at this low ball price. Now the actions start as a result of finding out that there's an offer, maybe finding out that there's a listing, whatever it may be. You know, all of those things are facts that could be used by the property owner to try and demonstrate that there's intentional interference with either a contract or with a business expectancy.
Do you have an opinion as to the likelihood of the nuisance continuing after the close? So if I were buying a piece of property, the neighbor starts harassing the seller, what's the likelihood of that neighbor continuing that harassment with me after purchase?
Well, I want you to think about the mentality of someone who is intentionally doing these things in order to try and throw a monkey wrench into the sale. Do you think that that mentality is going to stop that activity once the sale occurs? The answer is
no.
Absolutely not. That's the mentality of the person. Now, that because somebody went ahead and bought it despite what they were doing, now it's almost escalating. They are really miffed that the sale took place despite their best efforts to try and deep six it. So now what they're going to do is continue the efforts, continue the actions after the closing. They're not going to be buddy-buddy.
Well, maybe
maybe
the neighbor just didn't like you. You know what I'm saying?
Well, but then they wouldn't engage in activity to try and stop the sale. They would do everything they could to assist the sale of the property.
Right.
If it was a personal thing. Again, you know, we're sort of speculating
right
here. But yeah, to anticipate or to think that the actions are going to stop once the sale occurs, I think, is wishful thinking.
Okay. Well, that I thought was
very
beneficial. I have a lot. I have a few.
Mm-hmm.
Things are selling. We need listings. Buyers, got some great quality buyers out there looking for property. And of course, we have the Amazing Race. So call if you want to list your house or talk about it. And call if you want to buy a house or talk about it. And call if you want to participate in the Amazing Race, whether it's coming. We do have $5 after party tickets available now, and the VIP tent is $20. August 16th, 780-3800.
It's back.